mismo consejo de nuevo.
Seguro.
Vamos.
Vaya.
¿Cómo?
Vaya.
Vamos. ¿Cómo?
Vaya.
Vamos.
Vaya. Vaya.
Y por revolución es sentimiento y corazón.
No es repetir en tu tema lo que dice mi canción.
Cuando no existía definición en tu oración.
Yo le brindé valor al miedo que existe en tu corazón.
Con razón.
A muchos le diga lo que mi alma grita. Clandestino no suplica.
El consejo invita.
A los papitos y las mamitas la pachanga te salpica.
A comerse lo que trae.
I'm really interested in Afro-Cuban rhythm and Afro-Cuban Lukumi Orisha worship, hip-hop archives, and sound and ethnography. That's like the core, if you want to, sort of keywords, right? But then it's all of those things, Afro-Cuban rhythm, Afro-Cuban Lukumi Orisha worship, hip-hop archives, and sound and ethnography. I follow those ideas or those interests to understand what they mean in the context of Cuba and within the Caribbean, and what they mean to approach this to understanding diaspora and places like, you know, multicultural places like Toronto, for example, which is where I'm living now. And it's really just mostly about thinking about, you know, the meaning of rhythm in society, the meaning of the practice of Lukumi Orisha and hip hop practice as an assemblage. Methodological assemblage to with which to do anthropological practice, and then through that I listen to the CDLA, and I also do work around these ideas of, you know, foregrounding sound as ways to understand what people mean in society, specifically Afro-Cubans, Afro-Caribbeans, and Afro-diasporans.
Flores del Brasil.
EPEMP,
Grandes Ligas, América 2000, Historia del Pequeño Enzo Aracena, Camina Sin Ponerse Freno.
This is really key because this year we celebrate, in November, we celebrate the 50th anniversary of hip-hop culture. And it comes, this thing of listening or hearing and trying to pay attention to what people who are attending to people's listening practices and playback practices as well, comes from my practice as a hip hop producer in Havana. Specifically, what I would call an auditory encounter, my auditory encounter with the city of Havana, which came through this particular event of, you know, sampling record and vinyl records in Havana, or sampling CDs in Havana of music that I wanted to use for my own beats, my Afro-Cuban beats. And a beat making practice, and then listening to the same songs I had to sample, hear my neighbors play them as I walk to, you know, go back into the city or something. So I would sample something like, say, some boleros or something like that, and then my neighbors in the other block would be playing the song that I had to sample at home for an African. So that was like, so then that made me. This is the beginning of, this is like sort of the initial phase of this, what I call this auditory encounter. But the second stage of that auditory encounter happened when I went to, after I came back to Havana to look after my dad and for just briefly, like 15 days, I was doing my master's in sound design at the University of Edinburgh. And I had already started carrying out recordings in Edinburgh and, like, you know, listening and basically specifically binaural recordings, which is like you have this recordings where you put a microphones in your ear. So you record the city as if you're listening to it, right? So it's like, this is kind of, it is called binaural recording. So microphones. So with these microphones and having done that in Edinburgh, when I arrived to Havana, what really, really was interesting here is that those boleros were not playing anymore. My neighbors were not playing boleros anymore.
Huh.
My neighbors, not only my neighbors, but also there was this really ubiquitous presence of reggaeton music in many places of the city. This is the beginning of reggaeton in Havana. Although it had already started around the earlier 20th and 2000s. By 2004, 2005, even 2006, reggaeton was really, really strong as a sound or as a sonic shift in the sound of the city of Havana.
Tú eres así, que tú te vas por encima. Sandunguera, que tú te vas por encima. Tú eres así, que tú te vas por encima.
So that this is where this Afro, this what I call this auditory encounter, then has its other layer where. So that this is where this Afro started through the practice of sampling, to listen to the city and understanding the city as like this sort of audio culture of Havana, that, you know, included recording trucks, recording the train, recording roosters, and you know in the morning, recording people talking. And sampling all of that into some of the tracks that I was making, or some of the beats that I was making, and then coming back to Havana after, you know, a few months into my master's in sound design practice, and then realizing that the sonic character, or the audible character, or sonorous character of Havana had changed completely, or in some radical ways. So. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of where it comes from, this really, this big interest in sound.
Y tú me quieres tumbar,
¿con qué tú cuentas?
Y tú me quieres golpear,
¿con qué tú cuentas?
Y tú me quieres comprar,
¿con qué tú cuentas?
Cinco ceros, uno nada más.
Being part of several academic book projects and research projects, and you know, being interviewed before by, you know, different media, documentary, press, etc., and then having my own questions about Cuban society, right? Mm-hmm. Specifically about Cuban society, and about what I felt that we were doing in Cuban society, and what we're trying to say to Cuban society, and in trying to find the answers for those questions that I had in those books or projects that I participated, but then realizing that those were not really answering my questions. Mm. They were answering questions that came from the outside of Cuba specifically, to answer, you know, in many ways, mostly debates that were happening outside of Cuba. But, you know, it obviously touched Cuba in many ways, in very smart ways, but didn't really address the questions that not only I, but other people who I worked with in Havana had about our society. So really, this interdisciplinary practice, which is kind of a way to sort of juggle several things to try to make sense, right? It's really about trying to foreground the voice, my voice as an insider, in places where my voice has not been before. Mm.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just trying to, it's like a malabar. It's like the word in Spanish is like sort of juggle, so you can sort of, it's like almost like a gesture in some way, right? So try to make sure that something that will trick people to understand me in some way or another. But really the point here is to make sense for people who are not Cuban, and to tell my story the way I can explain it, and with the ideas that I want people to understand, not speaking to particular debates, not speaking to particular schools of thought, but just saying, this is who I am, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is what I think we represent. This is what I think we mean.
Mm-hmm.
So in a sense, you know, you could consider that this multidisciplinary practice speaks to, you know, having particular access or discernment into particular skills that, you know, to demonstrate that we are able as people, that we're not just there to be the anthropologized.
Uh-huh.
We could also be anthropologists. We could also be scholars. We can speak for ourselves. We have our own voice. This is what this is what this is really about. And I think really what's at the bottom, or what's behind this practice of you know, interdisciplinarity and multimedia expertise, is about what, you know, many people have described as poetics, but not poetics in terms of poetry only or verse, but more as gestures, right? Ideological, political, social gestures, right? And this is not just me. A lot of us, I have friends I work with where, you know, the first MC in Havana, the first beat maker in Havana, who now is a big rock star doing music. And none of us, you see what I'm saying? None of us are readily seen or visible because this is part of the paradigm in which within which we live in this sort of colonial world. So I mean, I have friends who were it doesn't mean that they were not the best in school, but like, for example, they studied sports. They were wrestling fighters for sport. They went to Cuba's best wrestling school, and then that same person became the first MC, the first solo MC in Cuba. That same person went and worked in London at Pret a Manger, learned English, and then moved to Sweden. Now speaks English. Now speaks Swedish. The capacity, human capacity. I think really what this idea of interdisciplinarity and multimedia expertise speaks about our human capacity.
Mm.
And of those who, like me, from my generation, what we're able to do.
Right.
And the kind of education that we've received as well.
Pasan los años y la situación prosigue intacta. El tiempo no perdona. Pregúntale a La Habana, que ahorita está en la lona. Nadie le importa nada.
No.
Tengo una raza oscura y discriminada. Tengo una jornada que me exige y no da nada.
Nada.
Tengo tantas cosas que no puedo ni tocarlas. Tengo instalaciones que no puedo ni pisarlas. Tengo libertad entre un paréntesis de hierro. Tengo tantos derechos sin provechos que me encierro. Tengo lo que tengo sin tener lo que he tenido. Tienes que reflexionar y asimilar el contenido.
The first sort of the initial ways of understanding hip hop culture that I had when I was in Havana around 1991. This is a little years later from my first encounter with hip hop, but like around 1991, the way I understood hip hop and the way I continue to consume hip hop is through video. So what you see in those sort of video practices is an evolution of my how film and cinema has basically influenced me and who I am. I think I may have actually watched a lot more movies than read books, to be honest.
Okay.
So it's basically, it's kind of like an easier way to speak in some ways, or at least for me. It's like, let me just put these images and like speak and try to make my songs look like, or whatever I'm trying to say in research.
Mm.
Say it as if it is a music video of the type of, you know, the MTV type, or maybe I would use the sort of the black background with white letters in the way that, you know, Antonioni used it.
Un día que te canto de nuestra pasión, que te canto de nuestro dolor, que no es fuma.
The only thing to say about this is Havana is a very cultured city, right? It's an extremely cultured city. There's a lot that you can access to. At least I had access to when I was growing up. And so all of that information is what you see, is all that music, all those videos, all the cinema, it's really where it comes from. I mean, I think it's also a way to, it also, the end of that conversation would be that because I speak through all these different sort of, you know, registers, if you want to call them, it's difficult to just attain a practice like anthropology and not try to flip it on its head to say something anthropologically through video or through sound, right? And in this particular way, this, you know, the kind of person that I am, it speaks about the, you know, new demographics in academic work, in scholarship, right, and in academic practices, right. So this idea of new demographics come from you know, people who've talked about you know, particular demographic turns in anthropological work. Mm. When I'm talking about Herndon and you know Edmund, you know, Pike, and see people who've talked about, you know, what exactly happens or how complicated it is for someone who was an anthropologized person like me. I was in Havana, people would come to interview me, so then for me to then become the anthropologist and how I speak, right? So, well, is it possible? Can I be objective? Is really the question,
right?
You know, so I mean, in a sense, is it does that matter? Is it important for me to be objective, or can I be subjective? Or, you know, in which ways, and this is the question, in which ways being objective is part of the colonial project or not, right? Mm-hmm. And being objective, does that mean that should I participate in it, or should I kind of do myself and speak about myself and make sure that I speak with my own terms? Mm. And so this is really what I think was at the bottom of this new demographics. And I guess people would say that started around the 1980s, mm-hmm. But it's been a major move, and you know, we have anthropologists from Papua New Guinea, you have anthropologists from Africa, you have, so this is, I, because I'm kind of part of that generation in a sense, from the Caribbean, and specifically from the biggest island in the Caribbean, I speak, this is my inflection, which actually goes back to the beginning that I was talking about this issue, like, mm-hmm. I don't sound like someone you've heard before, because you haven't heard me before. Mm. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So because I'm part of a new generation of people who are coming from this other sites, and I should say othered sites, yeah. To use academic work as a way to also place ourselves in the world and describe the way we see the world in our cosmologies, right? Centering sound and music, speaking sound specifically in this case, to talk about these issues of, you know, protest, oppression, culture, resistance, justice, power, affect. Mm. It's a way to sort of regurgitate particular practice that somehow we sort of take for given. You know, we already went through that. We wrote about that. Mm. So my question, did you listen to it? Okay, right. You wrote about it, you saw it, but did you listen to it? And did you write about it once you listened to it? Mm. Mm-hmm. And I think, let me just say, to not sound too, I think part of the practices in ethnographic work, the first thing that happens is that we enter the field with our ears, we enter the field with our eyes, right? But then we tend to take the idea back to our, you know, wherever we go back, post-field work, and then sit down and think and narrativize.
Yes.
What we experienced. But we usually, because we narrativize it, and we have to do this particular practice of ethnographic work. This is for anthropologists. Specifically, we tend to sort of not exactly disregard, because there's a lot of work on sound studies that's actually, you know, foreground sound. But there's other scholarship that's actually, I wouldn't say disregard, but yes, maybe disregard the importance of what they heard.
Yeah.
Right. And then with this issue of affect specifically, in terms of what people have heard, part of the work that I'm doing also with what happens in Havana is related to what I would just describe as historical non-listening. In the case of Afro-Cuban music, in particular commentaries that the Afro-Cuban community have made about Cuban society, about how we want to participate in Cuban society, and about our need to feel included, and our offer of advice to the nation and society, and how historically that has not been listened to on purpose. Right, so it's like, you said that, but this is what we're gonna do.
El ejemplo lo tenemos a la vista. Nadie que analice imparcialmente dudará de la buena fe de Fidel y de su mejor deseo en acabar la disociadora discriminación racial que estorba la consolidación de nuestro pueblo y entorpece el desarrollo económico nacional al privar de poder adquisitivo a una porción considerable de la población. No obstante, a ningún observador honesto se le escapará que el negro ha sido excluido hoy más aún que en ocasiones anteriores de la administración pública. Como el doctor Fidel Castro no puede estar en todas partes, le sucede a él lo que desde que el mundo es mundo le ha sucedido siempre a los hombres de Estado, que sus colaboradores, al no tener exactamente sus mismos sentimientos y sus mismas convicciones, tratan por todos los medios posibles de esquivar, de burlar y de desobedecer cuantas disposiciones les resulten chocantes o molestas. Y no hay que decir que la cuestión racial, eso de hacerle justicia al negro, de sacarlo de lo propio en que lo tienen sumido, le ha resultado chocante y molesto a muchos, que da la casualidad que tienen poder para no emplearlos, aumentando así el hambre y la miseria en los cubanos de piel oscura.
I think that this speaks about this culture, specifically cultures of protest, and cultures of resistance, cultures of claims for justice, and practices, ideological practices of power, right? That that happen in ways that you can hear them more than you can completely write about them. This is kind of like what's really at the core of my work is like how these tensions continue to be heard, but we somehow talk about, we do mention them. And there's many ways in which we do it, but as someone who is doing my own work and with my own approach, I feel like I'm discovering it anew, right? This is my own discovery. It doesn't mean that people haven't seen it before, or that people have not heard it before, or people haven't heard or actually protested about it before. It's just that I'm discovering it for the first time, and this is the first time in Canada. It's a really, really pertinent question that Mark Camp has asked me, and he may feel like this is kind of funny, but he said, well, what do you know about Canada? I said, well, I've been here for 12 months now. It's enough time for field work. So I kind of feel like, as an anthropologist, I have a certain amount of experience here to say, well, I continue to be not bothered, but inclined to think about this air horn thing. And like, I really don't understand what it means. Like, what exactly is it about it? Right. So this is part of the commentary and that's implicit in these practices of centering sound, which is obviously with the sound studies turn and the poetic turns. I think we're going in new epistemologies that this center visual or what we see and resent the other ways, sensorial ways in which we engage, life, right? And also, obviously, a lot of it's come also from practices that have to do with Lukumi Orisha worship, where listening well is a virtue, it's a virtue, it's a moral virtue, right? But an ethical virtue, so. I think what I'm trying to understand, for myself in a personal way, I'm trying to understand what it is to be Afro-Cuban as a human capacity, right? Or as a human as a human sort of condition, right? Mm-hmm. And what that means and what that implies in terms of ethical practices and in terms of commitments, right? And compromises, mm-hmm. and how that in some way, in what way or another that challenges the practices, my disciplinary treatment and training. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Something that I didn't say about and I would kind of want to go into this thing of the music again, because I addressed the issue of sound, but I didn't talk about the issue of music when I talked about research. I think it's really, and this is just only something that I'm beginning to do now. I haven't really done much about it, but this is the issue of entrainment that I was reading about when I was applying for a job within music theory, which is how an orchestra sound like one instrument, right? So it's being everyone is entrained.
I see.
And we all play unison, or we all play when it is our part, but we all are one particular organism in rhythm, right? Or entrained. I'm sure musicologists will have a lot to say about, or like, that's not what it means, but this is how I understand it. So in a sense, I think that this issue of entrainment in music theory, if we apply it to multicultural places like Toronto, for example, how do we all move as one society, right? Or places like Havana, or places like, you know, especially Havana, or where I lived, or Santiago de Cuba, or Edinburgh. How do we participate in one particular rhythm, right? Or not? How do we participate or not participate in one particular rhythm? And how does that qualify for our human condition and our human capacities, right? So this is the other way in which I apply music theory to my own work in anthropology, and to try to understand, you know, should we all play to, you know, who's leading, who's got the baton, or not the baton, the, I forget, the back, it's batuta is the name in Spanish, like the conductor, who's conducting the, you know, the rhythm of this, you know, social orchestras within which we live, right?